will start. So we'll talk about 6 weeks to migrate. To migrate to what? To migrate to the cloud and to migrate to Kubernetes. First, I will briefly introduce myself. My name is Aurore. It's quite a hard name to pronounce when you are not French. I guess my parents didn't want me to travel, but I love them anyway. I'm the co-founder and CTO of Paddock. We are a small French company, and basically we help companies to migrate to the cloud with Kubernetes. That's for the work part. For the other side, I'm co-organizing some meetups in Paris called the Human Talk. And actually, we have this kind of meetup in 11 cities in France. And the concept is simple. It's 4 talks of 10 minutes each. And like that, you can discover a subject. And if you're interested in, you can dig in after. If you want to start Human Talks in Hamburg, feel free to reach me after the talk. And I like running, and I'm trying to do some surf. I like to start my talks with some figures. So the first one is 2.9. The second one is 35. And the last one is 2. So what are those figures? Actually, 2.9 is for 2.9 out of 5. So I will tell you more about one project in particular. So we worked with a team of 8 to 10 developers, and they were developing basically an app like Uber. So you can book a car, use it, and you don't have a driver, so it's not like Uber, but you basically book a car, take it, drive it, and let it. And 2.9 was the average rate on Android and Apple stores, so not really a great grade. 2 days. Today was the time needed to test a full release. And when I said to test, it was basically by the product owner, because there was no QA team. 35 seconds was the time for a backend developer to see its changes. So with his Vagrant, basically he was making a change in the code, waiting for 35 seconds, realize that he forgot, I don't know, a comma or a this dot something, and do it again and again and again. So the developer experience of the project was not really good, could be explained by a lot of reasons, but when we arrived, the project was at this state. And the last figure I want to give you, it's not a contractual figure, actually, because it was not really measured, but we estimate that the availability of the platform was 96%. And when I say the availability, I'm not talking about like error rate or something else. I say like 4% of the time the server was down, so nothing could happen. So at that point, we try to came like this and say, OK, we'll help you to change. We'll do your best to give you a real developer experience and a real user experience. And we'll let you help people, Parisian, to rent a car and drive it. I say, OK, cool, but you've got 6 weeks. So I don't know how to say it in English, actually, but you say, OK, let's go. And actually, there were some up and downs. So I will tell you three things we were happy to think about it before actually migrating, and three things we wish we knew before migrate. So I will start with the bad experience first. So what are the three things I wish I knew before starting this project? The first thing is that whales could be difficult animals. So I heard some talks this morning saying that decoration is easy. In our case, is usually the phases actually the phase that can explode. Why? There is many reasons for. The first one is that as a HOPS team, as a SRE team, sometimes we don't know actually the developer's expectations. So for instance, if we speak about live reload, it was a Node.js application. And before we start the project, like 2 or 3 weeks just before they decided to migrate the entire code base to TypeScript. TypeScript, it's a way to do type checking in JavaScript, so you have to compile your code every time you made a change. It's good because it helps you to prevent some bugs, but in terms of live reload, it was not really that good, and we had a lot of trouble finding the right library to enable live reload. Another thing that we didn't know is that we wanted to help developers to debug, so we integrated the debugging mode of NotDaemon, and so actually I have a developer, I used to be a developer, so I was the one making the test. And I said, okay, yeah, we can debug. If I put a breakpoint, it stops and I can debug. And when we put our Docker in the hand of the other developers, they were making some weird thing. I said, no, I cannot debug. And so basically, if we are talking in terms of Scrum, we didn't have any definition of done. So all what we've done, we made some rework on it. Another thing is that when you know your application, you get used to some stuff that are quite weird, and we end up like dockerizing some libraries that were not actually supported anymore. So, if you for instance want to integrate PhantomJS in your Docker, you have two solutions. Either you containerize it anyway, so you make all the effort to install it, you download some weird zip, and so on. Either you ask to your developer to change library. Actually, on this one, we lose, and so we end up with PhantomJS in our Docker. But we still ask for applicative changes. When we started this project, developer was, yeah, our app is stateless, of course. But yes, our app was almost stateless. And we push and we push and we push and we engage them to do some applicative changes. So even if your developer say, yeah, yeah, my app is perfect, you can put it in Docker, I'm sure. Just be careful. And the last thing about Dockerization, we lost actually a lot of time. Because we say, okay, we started with the developer environment, so we say, okay, you have your Docker, you have your Docker Compose at that time, so you can work on this. And actually, we spend, I think, like a week to make this system, this Docker file, this Dockerized application working with the old way to deploy to the old servers. And it was something that we knew we will throw it after. So when we start new migration today, what we do is that we dockerize the developer environment, we make a staging, so a pre-prod environment, and when we are migrating the developer to Docker, we migrate them as well to the pre-prod environment. The second thing, and I heard about this also this morning, is that cruns are not friendly. So we'll start with some math. So on the old server, we have 2.5 CPUs for 3 APIs and one really small BDD. And after, in our cluster, we had 12 CPUs for 9 APIs because we have 3 APIs and we decided to have three pods of each. So on the paper, everything works. So we started the environment production and we start to make some stress tests, some load testing, and actually it was really, 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 really bad. It was like always getting slow, 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 and then all our nodes were completely full and the API were not available at all. And we figured that we have actually 9 APIs, but we had like 32 crowns. And so part of these APIs, and actually the one with the 32 crowns, were Symfony APIs. And a crown with Symfony is like you build the app, you build the API, and rather than like launching PHP FPM to start the PHP process, you launch a command like bin console and I don't know, my cron starts and everything. And the command is running and then stops, the Docker stops, and the pod stop. But at the first, you are launching your APIs. So at one point, we have like 25 API running at one time in the cluster. So that was our big mistake. Actually, it delayed the migration. So we are glad that we didn't migrate without load testing, so make load testing, but it delayed the migration for like a week. And we ended up like having a bigger cluster in the cloud than before. And for the record, we use some volume and some init container to have like all the stuff required to launch the API, like the composer install all the dependency, to make it once for all the crowns. Yeah, so sorry, I missed my slide, but a cron is an API because if you look at the two YAML files, on the left side you have the deployment one, and on the right side the cron one. And what you can see is that a cron job is basically, it will launch a job will launch a pod, the pod will launch your API, and you see that you have the exact same image, but you have an argument with a command. The third thing we learned the hard way is don't keep too many secrets. So on this project we launched and after the migration, I think like three times a day, we had a developer asking to make a change in the secrets of the API. So first we made it, then we automated the process from a Trello card from a demand to make it automation, but still we were like, but why did they need to change a secret so often? And actually, we made a mistake. Because in a lot of applications, it's case for Symfony or for the framework we use for Node.js, which is loopback, you have configurations file. And in these configuration files, you have all kinds of parameters. You have parameters that you don't want to keep secret. Actually, the client CCY, me as an ops, I don't care to change it, and it should be something handled by the developer. But of course, the database is password. I don't want it to be committed in the source code. And at first, when it was a config file, we say, okay, we have some private information in it, we'll put it as a secret. And we end up making so many changes in our secrets that we decided to actually rethink about our environment variable. So what is something that actually does not need to be hidden, and what is something need to be hidden? And actually, since we split, we didn't make any changes in our secrets. Now, let's talk about the three things we were happy to think about. So the first thing is run tests, a lot of tests. So there is a lot of way to run tests. The first thing is that you can run like automatic tests, like unit tests, end-to-end tests. It catch up a lot of issues, but it does not catch all. So we run manual tests. Why? Because, for instance, in this application, there was a service to geolocate all the cars, and it was not developed by the actual team. So it was an external services. And in all the end-to-end tests or unit tests, there was like a mock to mock the response. And when we start actually trying to book a car with our new production environment, we realized that our IP was whitelisted at their services. So if we launch in production without manual tests, actually, I think that renting a car would not have been possible for like half a day, which is not possible in our case. So it's really something that, it's a migration, it's a big thing, so it takes time, and it's sometimes quite boring because you don't have scripts to do it, but run manual tests. With your prod data, so what we've done, we decided to dump the prod database, we run a script to anonymize the database, we put some real email in it, so like mine or the other one, to be sure like to test the full loop, and actually it's the same as for the manual test, you need to experience your app before migrate. And finally, launch the most greedy request. This one is really important to me because actually we had a firewall in front of our app and we had some parameters to be prepared to DDoS attack. And so one of the most greedy requests we had in the app was a request to export all the invoices of all the users. At that time, we had like 22,000 users in the app. So we launched the request. And so first the request didn't complete. But after that, our app was completely done. Nothing possible with our app. So it was not really an issue because we were not really in production. But actually, what happened? We discovered that one of our services, so one of our group of pod, were actually the one responsible to launch all the invoices, was making a request, so going outside of the cluster and coming back inside the cluster to another group of pods. And so this 22,000 of time, so actually the firewall say, okay, I'm blocking this request, I'm blocking this IP, so the app was blocking itself. So if we didn't have test, if we hadn't test this request before, we would have actually locked ourselves from with the firewalls. Another thing that was quite tricky to handle at first was to handle our DNS, and actually to rent a car, it's a mobile app, so to handle it well with the mobile app. So how did we do? First, and I think you should all do that, because in most of cases it's possible, first negotiate some downtimes. As I said, it was like 96% of availability. 2 minutes of downtime when it's controlled was not really a big deal for our client. It's not possible for all the business, but when it's possible, you really should push your product owner to accept this downtime. Then you have two cases. Either you take advantage of this migration to change the API URL. Oh, sorry. First case, you are not changing the URL, so you are keeping the old one. So first, like we do it 1 or 2 days before, you decrease all your TTL to 60 seconds if it's possible. Or you put a proxy, so you have a proxy taking your request and migrate it to funnel the old services, and you will change it to the new services at the time of the migration. Either you're changing the API's URL, and in our case, it was the case because the old DNS was actually owned by the previous hosting company. So actually, you need to change it in your front-end application. So it's easy if it's website, but remember to keep the old one because you cannot, or at least you didn't want to force your user to update your mobile app when you're migrating your backend. It should be actually a non-event for them. So keep the old one and add it, like for instance, to your ingress definition, or make a DNS ribbon or a proxy as for the other one. But keep in mind that you cannot force your mobile user to update their application. And finally, I say three things that went well, but it's nothing related to container or nothing related to Kubernetes. But my advice is really to not migrate at midnight or at 1 a.m. or at 2 p.m. Actually, migrate at 5 a.m. Like that, you have time if before the service to be used. For instance, in our cases, like the jockey, so the one like moving the car, was starting to work at 6:30, and the traffic was really starting to come at 7:30. So we say we have like 2 hours in front of us to make our services running. And if you start migrate at 5, actually, usually you stay until 12, 1 p.m., 2 p.m., 3 p.m., and then you have a nap and you go home. But you are there while the service is starting to run. So you are there to see the issue. If you migrate at like 1 or 2, you say, okay, I'm migrate. Oh, I have this issue, I fix it, I'm fixing it. At 3 a.m., you go to bed, you come back at 10 a.m., like 2 hours after the real traffic starts, and actually you realize that something that you were not able to plan explode, and you were not there, you were sleeping. So that would be my fourth advice: migrate early rather than lately. So if we make a point on what happened, 4 is a new figure, 5 is a new figure, and 1 is a new figure. So actually, the grade went up to 4 out of 5. So I think it was like 4 or 5 months after. So why? First, the availability. We'll talk about this later. But as well, like migrating to the cloud and to Kubernetes helps the developer to actually develop better. So there was 3 API. We decided to migrate them as 3 APIs. So basically, we put a monolith in a Docker, and we put it in a pod, making sure that it's stateless. When we start doing this, developers were, wow, no, wait, we will cut this in like 4 parts, and this one in 5, and this one in 2, it will be much more better. And we say, okay, no, just let's migrate like this, and you do it better, and you do it better after. And actually, that's what happened. So they started to actually decouple their code, to isolate all the external services, to make sure that we can monitor, to make sure that the app is still able to working if one of the external services is down. So I think right now they don't have like 3 APIs, they have more like 6 or 7 APIs, because for them it's much more easier to decouple their code. 1 hour is the time required to do the last manual test they want to do after a release. Now they are releasing like every 2 days, I think, or 2 or 3 days. And 5 seconds is the auto-reloading time. So we wanted to have it below 2 seconds, but because of TypeScript, was quite hard for us. And finally, the availability of the platform since we migrate is 99.99. And this figure, we are sure, because we are able to monitoring it. I think the stress make me going really fast, so thank you. And if you have some question, I would be happy to answer. Yes. We are still maintaining the platform, but there is not someone 100% available. We do like 24-hour support if there is an incident, but for change management, it's like half day a week, I think. And we really try to, every week, we make a point on all the demands we had from the developer and say, okay, this one, it's still on our side, but this one, we want you to be able to run it, and we find a way to either train them, either automating it, because we don't want to be I don't know the English word, but you know this. Okay, yeah. Thank you. No further question? Yeah. Yeah. It was really libraries, this new TypeScript thing that was not actually hard for running Docker in pre-prod and prod, but really hard to make it a great experience out of it for the developers. And something I didn't mention, but actually developers were used to their Vagrant, and we had sometimes to train them to their Docker. It's like, It's funny because they knew that they wanted to move to Docker, but when they actually moved to Docker, it was like, I don't understand anything, and so you have to train and take time. But it was more fun rather than annoying, this part. Okay. Okay. Thank you.